Anna had mentioned that too.
Getting the audio level right is really, really difficult for me. I'm sure there's an easy way to do it, but like my little mixer resets every time I do it, and I get frustrated and have to do it every time we start a new stream.
Yeah, that's annoying. I feel like there should be like you should be able to save your settings.
Yeah. All right. Well, last week do you want to just start talking? Because I remember last week we talked about going about this a different way. And so I've actually got, I want to talk about some things directly from the book before we get into the characters. And then the way that my notes worked was, my screenshots were taken in alphabetical order. So according to what I have, we would be going through Egwene and then Matt and then Nynaeve and then Rand. And then Perrin and then Rand. So I don't know if you wanted to go a different route, but I have it in character order in their arc for the episode.
Almost feels like it kind of, not quite, but almost goes in a path of least important in this episode to who had the largest jump, you know, with like Egwene and Matt in the beginning. Like they had their moments, but I don't really feel like they quite compared to Nynaeve and Rand and Perrin.
Right.
Mainly Nynaeve and Matt, or Nynaeve and Rand.
Yeah. I didn't know which, if you minded, if I talk about some things from the book first before we dive in. I don't know if you had a preference or... Okay. Okay, well, if we have any visitors, we're talking about The Wheel of Time, Season 2, Episode 3, titled What Might Be, and we're just going to dive in and start talking about it. Hopefully from a positive perspective. I think this episode is going to be more neutral than anything else, because there are some differences and some clunkiness to the episode is probably the best word. And anyways, my first item is actually this sketch that I made. It's awful. I didn't draw it in AutoCAD. I drew it in MS Paint, as you can tell. And this is... if you imagine the top arch leaning in towards the other two, or all three arches standing vertical, this is what the arches are described as in the book. They're supposed to be like a silverish ring at the bottom, and the arches have, obviously they have two legs, and where the one leg meets the other, they're connected to the ring on the bottom. And so like the size of the arch, like there's some geometry involved that's essentially what it would look like. And here's the description. I'm not going to read all of it, but you know, it talks about the arches and ring were all of one piece, you know. So I'm thinking in my head that I have a pretty good description of what these rings look like before we saw this on screen. So from my perspective, I didn't understand why they did it this way. Like they, I have my theories, and I guess we can talk about it when we get to Nynaeve's sections. But I like to see stuff from the book if it's plausible, and to me this feels like an easy win. How hard could it have been to? You're making the props already. How hard is it to put it the way it is in the book? Like why did we do that? Which, you know, is just a question I have. I'm not complaining, it's just a question. Next is, I just wanted to point out that a lot of what the Aes Sedai said when they were explaining things to Nynaeve do come directly from the book, but like we talked about with Avatar yesterday, delivery is key. When you listen to the audiobook or even read it on the paperback or Kindle or whatever, Shiryam's tone is always described as like motherly because she's the mistress of novices, and her actress really fell short. It was very, very cold, very detached, and it's kind of disappointing because, you know, she doesn't look like Shiryam, she's not talking like Shiryam, and it feels like a bad casting choice, which we've already talked about. A lot of the casting choices are excellent, so this is kind of a contrast of good versus bad. And anyways, this is what you know, these are the clips that I was looking at when I wanted to talk about this, because Shiryam has a very certain personality in the books, and that's what I was hoping for, because it would have made for some good contrast to the characters. So I have some theories about that too. When we get to Nynaeve's sections, we can talk about that. But that was it. Just the arches were bugging me, and Shiryam's character is kind of off balance. And then the only other thing was, I was curious why we were doing the hunt for the horn in Kyrian, and I was wrong. Like when I watched the show, I was like, well, that's not where the hunt for the horn happens. And it's not, but people get sworn to their oaths for the hunt, you know, for the great hunt anywhere, and then they travel to Ilion or whatever. So it's not out of place that they were talking about the hunt for the horn in this episode in Kyrian. But anyways, that was my little discussion about the books. I just like to try to cross-reference when I can, just for a sanity check on my part. I don't mind being wrong, but I'd rather not be wrong because I was careless, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. I think that's kind of a fitting way to go into this episode. Because from what you were saying, I think that there was some things that, kind of like the stuff that you just laid out, that they handled differently that they really didn't have to handle differently. And I think that just kind of helps me, because that's something I haven't read yet. So for me, that gives me a better perspective of how this story goes in the book versus how they're taking it in the show, because other than the show, I have no reference to pull from. So for me, it all makes sense. Everything seems like it fits for the most part, until I hear otherwise. So I appreciate that you take that approach.
Yeah, and I think it's easier now that we're in season two, because we've been talking about kind of like where the premise of the book and the show are different, and that's a given and it can't be changed. So now the challenge is almost like a little detective work. We've got a show that is new to you and a series that is old to me, but we don't know where they're going because they're changing things. It's almost turning into like a detective scenario for us the closer we get to the end of season two. Where is this gonna go? I know how it's supposed to end, but what is the show actually gonna do? And that's gonna be my driver to continue the show and try to enjoy it, is like, I want to guess. I want to try to anticipate, based on the changes that they've already made, what are we going to do going forward? And I'm going to have some theories as we get closer to the end. And I'm interested to see if my hot takes turn out to be true, because I'm guessing just as much as you are.
Yeah, absolutely. And we get to rage when our expectations aren't met. So it's going to be fun.
Yeah, well, so this episode is a little different. Last episode, it was really choppy, like we jumped all over the place with characters. And when we talked, I was like, all right, well, we'll just split up the characters and follow their arcs individually. And of course, as soon as I tried to do that, this episode spent like the first 15 minutes with Nynaeve. And I thought to myself, well, is this gonna work? And then I compounded that by having the characters, the scene order that they appeared in is not necessarily how their screenshots ended up in this folder, because I labeled them by name. So now it's alphabetical instead of like starting with Nynaeve. Like, we should have started with Nynaeve, but I have Egwene up first because of the ABCs. So hopefully you're okay with that. I mean, that's just the way I have it.
Do you think it would be better just to go ahead and skip all the way to Nynaeve's pictures? You know, I mean, it's just screenshots and shoot that way. Because I see the validity to your point that you brought up, in that this episode mainly focused around Nynaeve and Rand. And then, they touched on everybody, but the big plot of this episode was really Nynaeve. And so it might make more sense in the rest of our conversation to establish her arc first. But if you think that we can still make sense and go through this pretty organized, and I'm down for whatever path you want to take.
Well, it's a majority of it is up to your memory of the scene, and I don't know how your brain works. I have an almost scary memory when it comes to shows and like scene order and stuff. So like, I see this scene and I know that Egwene and Elaine are in Nynaeve's room with Shiryam on the other side, and that's Shiryam has just told Egwene that, you know, Nynaeve's dead. So without context, it would probably be confusing, but to me, this is simple. If you want to go to Nynaeve, then that's fine. I'm struggling with chronological order versus like character arcs, because this is technically Egwene's first scene in the episode. So, do you want to talk about Nynaeve, or do you want to talk about how upset Egwene is?
Yeah, I think for me, I would like to talk about Nynaeve first.
All right, give me a second to skip through.
I don't have that trait.
Okay, well, let's reset. So it's Nynaeve's not too far away. Here we have, this is the opening scene. So this is where we're at. We've got Nynaeve inside the down below the level of the main level of the tower. So we've gone down quite a bit. You can see some of the bedrock over there by the torches, and then the three Aes Sedai are talking to Nynaeve, and they're basically telling her she has to do this. She can try three times. If she goes in and starts, she can't quit, this and that. Like, their speech is close to book accurate, close enough that, you know, when they were talking, I recognized it.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I don't know how it went in the book. What I really took away from this was I felt Nynaeve's put in this position by Liandrin that she's just not she wasn't prepared for. She wasn't anticipating this. I mean, I think that they address that when they say that no one knows what goes on in this room until you're brought in here. But I feel like Nynaeve was really kind of led into this situation and is a bit unprepared. But Nynaeve is the type of person that's not going to turn down a challenge. She's got a bit of that ego, I think, too, where, you know, she's not going to look weak in front of anybody. And I think that kind of comes up as one of her trials in the Arches, and I'm excited to kind of get into that and what I interpreted the Arches and her trials as. I'm excited to hear about how accurate that is towards the book, or even if that has anything to do with the actual plot of the story. But I definitely felt that she was caught off guard with this.
It's interesting you say that, because the premise that she wasn't ready, or that she might not have been ready or anything like that, was not like, that was the opposite approach that the book took. The book basically, Varen is in the scene in the book, okay, and Varen is telling Nynaeve, like, she's trying to explain to Egwene how the tower works as a novice, and trying to get Egwene to control her power to learn. There's a set of weaves that she has to learn to become an Aes Sedai. It's like 100 weaves that they have to memorize very specifically. And you spend a lot of your time as novice and accepted preparing for that. And novice culture is mostly spent on shaping, like, obedience. And Varen tells Nynaeve, I don't think you're going to enjoy that, because typically novices are like 15 and you're 23. And, you know, so Varen tries to walk her through the exercises to embrace the one power, and Nynaeve gets flustered and gets up to walk out of the tent that they're in, and Varen goes, oh, by the way, novices scrub pots in the kitchen. And Nynaeve's like, fine. And then she sits back down, very stubborn, you know, like grudgingly taking advice and things like that. And so the other half of that is that this trial from novice to accepted is solely based on the strength of the individual, like, mentally, and there's nothing to do with the power. It all has to do with, like, how strong that person is as an individual. Somebody that's, you know, somebody like Nynaeve is going to succeed at it. Now, some circumstances happen in the book that made it difficult, but the overall comparison of this scene once she's in the arches to when she finally comes out is not too far off from the truth.
Take another step to her first trial.
Yeah, I'm. So one more thing is right here. I know they did this because this is a show that has a more general audience. But technically, she's supposed to be buck naked. They call it clothed in the light, and all women's ceremonies inside the White Tower are have to do with nudity. And I'm not mad. I'm not disappointed. Just making a point. I would not have complained for some book accuracy, people.
Fair enough.
They could have had her naked and just had the camera angle show her shoulders or whatever. I'm not saying that they had to show anything. I'm just saying that, like, part of being comfortable being naked in the White Tower is, like, that's part of being in the tower, is, like, there's all kinds of ceremonies involved that they're pretty much naked. I don't know why I didn't write the book, but anyways, so my next, a lot of these clips, I'm hoping I have some from when she's inside her. Of course not. Of course I didn't get the ones that I really should have gotten. So this is a setup for what happens when she enters the third arch. And that's it. It's just Shiryam telling Nynaeve, not even the one power will be available to you. The way these arches work is that it's supposed to wipe your memory and keep you from being able to, once it wipes your memory, you're not able to use the one power. I think, like, Shiryam explains in the book that she's, they've sent Aes Sedai in warded so that it wouldn't affect their memory and they die or get burned out. So, yeah, it's pretty harsh consequences for using this thing. Anyways, I was trying to see if this is our first real look at, like, Weaves of Spirit, You can see they're more hazy, they're more clear, they don't really have a color attached to them, not even white. I think these are more translucent than anything else. And I was just trying to get a good grasp of like the way they look, that way we can look for that later on, because spirit is a very uncommon weave of the one power, so I wanted to try to capture that. Her first arch, and I should have grabbed a screenshot of it, I don't know why I didn't, but her first arch in the show, she is holding Crimson Thorn Root. She has no idea where she's at. And then her father and her mother basically are treating her like a kid, and they get attacked by bandits. They fight them off, and then I think Nynaeve gets stabbed at one point, and then she hides in a cellar, and her mom tells her, you know, like, just stay in here. And then the arch opens back up, and you hear Shiriam's voice, the way back will come but once. And Nynaeve's forced to decide, do I go up and help my parents and save them, or do I go back to the White Tower? And she comes back extremely upset about that whole ordeal. And
yes,
that's the scene that is different from the books. The other two are pretty close. This one is very different.
So what I took from her first trial was I felt like it was a trial of vulnerability. You know, she's obvious. She's a kid. She's put in a position where she's kind of helpless. You know, her father gets attacked. He's kind of hurting her, where, you know, that's kind of the role that her father was taking in that battle is usually the role that Nynaeve is kind of taking, where she's, you know, hurting the people that she cares about to safety and getting them out of harm's way while she's, you know, using herself as a barrier between danger and the ones that she loves. And in this situation, she's obviously not. And you kind of see her mentality where she tries to break that. She tries to go back and help her dad, and she immediately just gets wrapped up with a bandit, and he, you know, manhandles her all the way down to the ground, starts stabbing her with a knife. She realizes that she's gonna lose. You know, she doesn't have the ability to fight this guy off, and her mom saves her.
Right.
And she kind of comes to that understanding that she is vulnerable in this moment, and that doesn't, you know, with Nynaeve's character, that does not sit well with her. And you could tell that conflicts with her internally, but she kind of settles in because of who's around her two parents. And she lets them take the lead. Like you said, goes down to the basement, and, you know, she's just in this state of shock. Her memory's wiped, you know, and it was kind of cool to see how fast she made her decision down in the basement. But that's what the first trial came across to me, was putting her in a position of vulnerability and seeing, will she accept humility or not? Maybe humility is the wrong word, but something along that line. I don't know if I might have the right words to get across that idea, but basically put her in a situation that kind of goes against her core value of being helpless. Will you leave that situation?
Yeah, maybe not humility, maybe vulnerability. I think you said at the beginning, maybe that's the word you're looking for.
Yeah.
It's interesting that you talk about her being vulnerable, because that is the essence of what happens when she goes to the first arch in the book. The gigantic hole is that she's reliving a scene that happens in the first book. Which is at the Eye of the World, she fights a Forsaken there. Like that whole scenario at the end of season one didn't play out the same at all, really. And Nynaeve fights a Forsaken called Aginor, and Aginor is a really awful person. And so when she goes through this arch, she has to face Aginor, and she is terrified at first, and then she gets pissed and uses the one power, even though she's not supposed to be able to. And anyway, that's the big difference. But the core concept of vulnerability when you're looking through your past is what she fears most. And that's what the Aes Sedai said. You go through the arch, you faced your worst fear from your past. And I thought that was, you know, overall that it achieved its goal. If you as a viewer picked up on that without knowing anything else, you picked up on the vulnerability and her being afraid and not really enjoying that very much. And I think that's a good thing.
Goes to the show. Now, did they state that in the show? If they did, I missed it, where they said that you go into the arch and you face your, like, I guess your worst fears from your past. Because from what I remember of their conversation where the Aes Sedai were explaining to her what happens, is basically it wasn't much. It was everybody's experiences is different. We don't know what happens inside the arches. Like I said, everybody's experience is different. And when you come back, it's your burden to bear. Don't tell us about it.
Right. It's essentially you're facing something about your past that is going to, whatever it is that pushes you to your limit about your past. It's not necessarily fear, but fear is associated with it. It's more about like whatever is the thing that will get to you the most about your past. So maybe I added the word fear in there, but the arch essentially works like if you had a traumatic experience in your past, you're going to be faced with it again, and it's going to be way worse. The arch amplifies whatever that is.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, I understand the mechanics of what you're saying. I was just asking, do you remember if they explained that to Nynaeve in the show? Because I don't.
My
memory is they didn't tell her anything. They said everybody is experiences something different, and that's really the extent of what they told her.
They tell her that I think they tell her at the very beginning that you have to face your fears in the arches.
Gotcha.
And then they talk about the fact that one arch is past and then present and then future. So I think they kind of get to the point, but in like not a direct route. They kind of go skirt around the subject, I guess.
I gotcha.
So the second arch. The second arch was interesting. It doesn't line up. I don't really care about that because I thought this whole second half of the scenario was an interesting concept. We see Nynaeve in a very confusing set of circumstances. She's swirling around. She thinks she's in a fight. She's being tossed around by something. And
this is the third arch, right?
This is the second arch. She's
really?
She's being tossed around. And interesting to me is that she's wearing red. So in this arch, she's clearly afraid of being part of the Red Aja if I follow what we did in the first arch. And she's got she's got an accepted ring on, wearing red. Like there's no gem in her ring. And I just thought that was interesting. You know, I don't really care if it's book accurate. This is an interesting thing because we don't get a lot of specifics for everything that happens in the arch. What we get here is that she's gone through this one and then she comes out and then she's like mad about it. Basically, I hope I'm remembering this right. Is this the third arch?
That's the third arch. It is.
The second arch is when
she's back in the Two Rivers.
The plague, right?
Correct. Yeah.
Oh yeah, that's right. Man, I should have taken more screenshots. That's an easy. I mean, that's almost one for one what that happens in the book. Is the my internet is absolutely shitting the bed right now. That's interesting. I've never seen red on my OBS for stream health. I wonder what that's about. Yeah, so...
I mean, so you're coming through pretty clear.
I'm dropping frames like crazy. So... Okay, alright, it's back now. I don't know what that was about. Weird. Anyways, so yeah, they do the plague thing. That happens in both the book and the show. A little bit different, but they essentially got the gist of it. And Nynaeve comes out in the book like super mad. Is it she's more desperate. Is it real? And everyone's like, we don't know. they don't confirm or deny, not out of malice or tough it up. It's we don't know.
Absolutely. I mean, these arches, I think Anna's words for it were they're brutal. I mean, and that comes across in the show. They do a good job of showing how, I mean, and that's credit to the actress. She does a great job of, you know, showing her real emotions in these situations. And in the second arch, you know, you see that guilt of responsibility that she carries, you know, and feeling like she let everybody down. And I felt like she had those strong emotions in that second arch, you know, because everybody's kind of looking at her. She's got half the people blaming her for everything that's going on. And then she's got the other half that are like looking at her as if she can't help them, but it's okay. And like with Tam, when he's like, you know, she's trying to heal him and he's like, it's okay, just stay with me. You know, that intense guilt that she feels because she carries that responsibility of the wisdom for the town and caring for everybody. And, you know, this has decimated her people. And because of her actions, somebody else was in the shoes that she should have been in and didn't handle this the way that she would have.
Right.
You know, you could see that conflict in her. And she still decided to walk away, you know, which was really cool to see.
It did play out a little bit differently. Like it wasn't Matt Cawthon's mom. It was like a wisdom from another village, and but the gist was the same. Like it was the same result. She ended up not wanting to leave, and she ended up leaving, and it, you know, she was really upset about it. So I thought it was a good scene. I enjoyed the second arch a lot, even though I clearly couldn't remember that it happened at first. The third arch to me is the one I wanted to talk about the most. You know, I knew the first one was going to be different. I knew the second one was going to be pretty close. This one is more interesting to me than anything else that they've decided to do in the book because it's clever. Clever in a way that, it's hard to say. Like, it's hard to describe exactly how and why it's clever. So I'll just tell you what happens in the book first, and then we can talk about what happens in the show, because they're close enough that I think the contrast should be talked about. So she goes in the third arch after she is essentially she's called a chicken by whoever's in the room with her, and she's like, I'll go through. And she goes through, and she's immediately met with, like the premise of the arch is that you lose your memory, right? So she gets into the arch, and she is immediately approached by Lan. They're married. They have a daughter. And she isn't supposed to be able to remember anything, but she's, like, got this visceral reaction to Lan and her daughter. And she's like, no, this isn't right. And Lan's like confused about it. Like, what do you mean, my love? You know, why are you leaving? And she's like, I I could stay here. I could. And the arch like fades out and she panics and embraces the source, even though she's not supposed to be able to. And she forces it back open and she leaves the arch with two thorns in her hands, because that's what she needed, the pain or whatever, to try to embrace the source, and forces them back open. Nobody inside the room even suspected anything was wrong until they looked at her hands and they were like, what the hell happened? And, you know, she's really upset. Her name was Elnor. You know, that was my daughter's name. Like, basically, like, super upset and justifiably so. And this third arch in the show, I thought was even better. I thought it was really good. She, you know, rejects the Aes Sedai, leaves the tower, meets up with Lan. Lan says, you know, well, let's go back home. You need to go back home. I'll go home with you. And then lives this whole life. And doesn't notice the arch shimmer. Holy shit.
They did a great way of portraying it, because in the beginning, I mean, she has this, you know, the images that you have up here, where she's going through this crazy, hard to, you know, fathom what's reality is happening inside this arch, and then she comes out with, I believe it's Lan's headband in her hand.
Yeah,
that's what I assumed.
Yeah, yeah. You can't see my mouse, but it's his headband.
You know, she rejects the White Tower because of, she's like, whatever I just did in there is not okay. If right. I did that to Lan, and walks out, and I was like, the first time watching, I was like, okay, like that was weird that I didn't really get to see the third trial, but she's just gonna ditch this now, and had me hook, line, and sinker, you know, watching this, thinking all this was real until the first arch pops up, and then you're like, oh, this is the trial. You know, that was really witty the way that they did that.
And it also, so I have a running theory about the mechanics of the world in this fantasy world, and that these Tirangriel specifically are tied to the World of Dreams. I have also a running theory that the World of Dreams is connected to all of the magic system, specifically objects like this. There's others that pop up. I have a overarching theory that the World of Dreams is also tied to pretty much everything that happens in the world. Everything is affected by the World of Dreams in some way. And one of the running themes is that in the World of Dreams, time doesn't move the same, or it doesn't have to. And so this is totally plausible. This is a really good move by the show, that they didn't just throw her in there with the memories already in place. They let her build those memories herself. I mean, her daughter's like, what, 4 or 5 when she sees the arch again?
Yeah, and she has this, you know, and built or continued her relationships with like Perrin and Matt, mm-hmm. you know, in that, and their relationships with her daughter. Like, she's, like you said, lived this whole life here.
Yeah.
You know, that's what made the scene for me so much more powerful when she came out, you know, like the tears that she had because of the pain. You know, she really had a daughter and tried to carry her out with her. And when she gets to the other side, her hands are empty, and this whole life that she lived, she just watched it come crashing down. Everybody she loved just got murdered in front of her 30 seconds ago. She tried mm-hmm. to get her daughter to safety, and then poof, it's all a different dimension, a different reality. It never existed or did it. She doesn't know.
That scream was awesome. Like, you could feel it. You could feel it.
It was powerful.
I don't know if you...
What stood out...
Hold on a second. You might see me throw up on stream real quick. I really want to go smoke, but I decided to buy some Zen. I was told that...
Oh, buddy.
I was told that the 3 milligrams are the lowest. the lowest that they have?
So I was playing Call of Duty with a friend who vapes, and he did the same thing, went and got a pack of Zens. He asked me because he knew I dipped. I was like, you know, I've had them. For me, they're not too bad. He threw one in immediately, like 5 minutes in, threw up. Had to get off stream.
Was he a smoker?
Yeah, he was a smoker. I think he had a weak stomach. You know, I don't think you'll throw up, but I think if you haven't done it before, I don't know if right now is the time to do it in the midst of a session. Up to you, man. Just a heavy caution.
Really? Because they're turning your stomach. They're that strong.
It's just different. It's a different thing.
Well, I feel that, like, that pressure, anxiety of the craving of needing a cigarette. I know you know what that feels like.
Yeah.
But, like, that's what's driving me. I'm either going to get really irritable for the next 45 minutes, or I need to go run outside for, like, 3 minutes. Your choice.
Go smoke. I would rather that than you feel sick and then have to try to finish this out with an upset stomach.
All right, well, let me run outside real quick. This is not a smoking stream. I don't condone this. Addiction is terrible. I hate every second of it. But yeah, I can feel it. It's like pressing down on me.
Don't listen to him. Give in to the dark side.
Hey, don't give me...
I'm about to pack a fat lip.
Don't give me fucking banned. What the hell's wrong with you? they have an option when I stream to do, like, is there heavy drug use? And I always put no. And I...
That's so aggressive. Who just right, does, like, yeah, we're just going to shoot up on stream.
Yeah. All right. I'm going to throw this other.
Yep.
All right, I'm back. Okay, so that's, I think that's Nynaeve's whole arc until the very end. And I have that grouped in with Egwene, I think. What'd you think overall?
The thing that I took from the third arch was, like, giving her happiness. And, sorry, I have some technical difficulties going on. But, I felt like, you know, she had to walk away from her happiness. I mean, at the end, with the Trollocs coming, it kind of knocks that down a little bit. I felt like the first time the arch appeared, it was like, do you want to take your happiness or do you want to come back? And she chose to stay, and then ultimately that went downhill for her. For me, I didn't know that she was using her one power throughout the arches in the book. But for me in the show, what stood out was that they said you cannot use your one power in the arches, and she didn't use it in the first two, and then at the last moment in the third arch she did. So that for me had an impact, but I guess overall compared to the book, it really doesn't play that big of a role. But man, what a hell of an episode for her.
It's interesting to me. Like, I thought the arches scenes in the show were done, especially the third arch was done really well. And she does that like explosion of power to push all the Trollocs away. And what they don't talk about is that, like, it's a running theme that the heroes of the story are kind of forced into it. And this is a good example. She's living a great life. She's turned away from the Aes Sedai and went on to live her best life. And now the consequences are at her front door. They kill Lan, they kill Matt, they kill Perrin, they kill everybody. And then she loses her daughter by going through the arch. So the consequences are essentially the same, and they just bring this theme a little bit forward in the book, or a little bit forward in the show than they do in the book, and that's fine. I overall, it was great. Like, I enjoyed this scene in particular a lot. I like the cleverness that the show writers had.
So that's a great way to put it, Mike. I didn't even think of it that way. As if the arches are trying to show her there is no path for you where you can escape your destiny of having to do what you're called upon for. You know, like, there is no running. You don't get to go live off and have a happy life, because ultimately you will pay the consequence for not doing what destiny or the will is weaving you to do.
Right.
You ready for my hot take?
Yeah, let's hear it.
I think Leandrin purposefully pushed her into the arches before she was ready. Just from what I could tell from the show, so I have no idea from the book, but for me, the way that Leandrin just tries to, like, snatch Nynaeve up in the White Tower, get her, you know, to the Red Aja, or see the ability or the power that they have. They don't need anybody. They are their own force. And tries to lure her in with that. And then she goes into the arch, and you see that whenever she doesn't come out, the girls are like, we never should have trusted you. Like, we were right in our initial belief that you shouldn't be interacting with novices, because this is not the first time you've messed up. And now you've messed up with our greatest weapon. And I think that it was really interesting to see Leandrin's reaction, because to me, I felt like what I saw was Leandrin pushed her into that purposefully, but she felt so conflicted about it because she had grown to respect and like Nynaeve. And so she felt remorseful about what she had to do. But I mean, what option does she have? You know, she's a dark friend. She's got to do what she's called upon to do. And that would be a way for her to get one of the Tarviren out of the picture. If she came out of the arches.
Okay, I have a counterpoint, I guess, to that. just a different way to think about the same scenario, just from her perspective. So the running theme for Dark Friends is that they're selfish, ambitious, and crave power. And I don't necessarily think she was trying to push Nynaeve because she wasn't ready. I think she was pushing Nynaeve because if she could get Nynaeve through the arches and back out, Nynaeve would owe her. And then she would be able to leverage that to get Nynaeve to like, if Nynaeve made it through, Leandra could continue to work on her as an accepted and pull her in closer. Like, look what I helped you do. You owe me, essentially. Like, that was the take that I had on it, because she was genuinely upset when Nynaeve didn't come out. Like, she threw the chalice. Absolutely. Was pissed, and you know, that was my take. I like your take. I think it's a little different, personally.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you have a better understanding of the overall picture of the whole story than I do. But I mean, yeah, that makes perfect sense as well. I think the main point is that Leandra was putting her in a position she wasn't ready for on purpose.
Right.
And I mean, you know, her intention, I don't know. The one that you laid out makes sense as well, more sense. I think that a reaction she had to that was letting Matt go in a way to kind of balance itself out. I mean, she has her own intentions with her or with Matt and Min. But I could just see the guilt she felt because of the situation that she created, and I'm talking about Leandrin. Something just sat fishy with me right there. And another thing I noticed is I feel like there's a dark friend with every single Tarvirin in the show currently at the moment. I don't know all of them, but I feel like in this episode specifically, I can almost pick every dark friend that's with one of the five.
That is a theme in the books that you don't even get a hint of until much later. This is one of those things of like the show escalating themes from the series as a whole and compressing it. And that's a good catch. I don't really want to confirm it, but essentially you're right. It almost as soon as possible, the Dark Friends are swarming the heroes, I guess. Like, they're everywhere. There's a lot of them. And I think your statement is true. I think that there are dark friends with all the kids. I'm just gonna call them the kids. I think. Pretty sure.
I think Perrin's around two of them in this episode. Ingtar is still number one sussy for me. He's okay. At the top of my wanted board. Not confident in him. Do I like him as a person? Yes, I do. Do I trust him? No.
I'm still counting six overall dark friends that I saw on screen this episode. So I haven't seen any
girl
new
with
ones.
The fingernails.
Okay.
Leandrin. Why do I always blink on her name?
Celine.
The girl with Rand.
Celine.
And for me, Ingtar. And the last one, well, you had six. I've only counted four. Whew.
Well, I'm counting Ishamael, or the Dark One, or whatever you want to call
him.
Oh,
okay. Ishamael. Yep. So that's five for me. So there's one I'm missing. Oh, man, that's tough. Don't let it be the Builder. Son of a bitch.
The Builder? Oh, that would be nice.
That would be savage.
I don't know. He's pretty mad at the injustices where Perrin is at. I mean, I guess he could be a good actor. Maybe.
Nah, I don't think it's him. I'm just imagine. It'd be funny if it was.
Speaking of this, So we're already about an hour in. I don't know how much more time you have. I didn't realize we were going to talk so much about Nynaeve. It makes sense. I didn't think I was going to enjoy this episode as much.
That's a good thing, because we were a little pessimistic, I think, the both of us going into this.
Yeah. So I wanted to, my next on my list is Perrin, just in sequential order, or we can go back to Egwene. It doesn't matter to me.
Yep, we can stick with Perrin. Just a touchy subject's about to come up that I've been not looking forward to for like a week and a half now.
Really?
Yep. I think we should take a moment of silence, if I'm being quite honest.
I did not take a screenshot of that scene, although in hindsight I probably should have, just to torment you.
Well, that's mean, number one, and I'm glad that that's on record, that that's the kind of friend you are.
I didn't.
And
I didn't take the screenshot.
By accident, not even on purpose. So, we can dive into Perrin. I think he had the second most fascinating arc in this episode.
Okay.
Just because of everything that was going on with him and the people around him.
Okay, I wanted to talk about this scene here with the Damani, the chick with the collar and the pacifier.
Yep.
I'm always trying to, like, in my head improve, like, what could improve the scene to make it feel more like the book, because I want it to feel like the book. That's what I want. I want to watch it and feel that hit, like, yes, these connect, this is good. And this scene here is where the Damani is like pointing out girls and they're being taken, but you don't see why. Those women can channel. That's what she's doing. She's picking them out, and I feel like the scene would have gone better if they had been putting collars on those women instead of just dragging them away. I think it would have made a much more horrifying scene to have her like wrap them in air, throw a collar on them, and like essentially torture them into obedience, like right there in front of everybody. Like, you're my pet now. Congratulations. That would have been horrifying.
Is that how it happened in the book?
You don't get to see it a lot on screen. The first time we see the women collared is Egwene's capture in the books, and it is awful. It is. You get to see it from her POV, and it's terrible. But I think it would have been a good adjustment. It probably would have been. I think it would have been appropriately traumatic to show that from like a perspective of a group. It's already a terrible thing. One of the things that I did notice is that this chick in particular seems to walk around like she's the boss a lot. And then the chick in the background who's actually in charge of her is kind of almost looks deferential. And that's backwards. This chick with the pacifier is supposed to be very meek. Or very determined to please her Suldam. So I don't see a lot of meekness or deference to her Suldam at all. What I see is a badass channeler walking around like she's invincible.
Yeah, I definitely got that vibe too. And I think that you made a good point that could have been a way that they handled this scene right here differently. For me, the first time I watched this, I had no idea what she was doing when she was picking people out. At first I thought that they were trying to pick people out that they were going to use as collateral if the people of the town didn't do what they said. The second time through, I had a feeling that because she's somebody who could channel and she's picking people out and it's all women, I kind of pieced it all together. But I didn't do that until, you know, I've watched the whole season in conclusion. And I know right. What she is and what's going on. So, yeah, I think the way that you laid it out would have made much more sense to the viewer, because as somebody watching it for the first time, I did not piece that together. Because up until now, you have no idea what this Damani is. You don't understand the relationship or the situation of what's going on, who the Seanchan are, really.
Right. It's a pacing issue with the show. The other way they could have done it is have like Perrin and company meet one of these girls that gets taken before they get to the village, and the girl like heals them or something, like very, very secretively, like, I'm not supposed to channel because I'm not an Aes Sedai, but I can heal you. And then she does, and then we get to this village, and then she gets captured, and then you mentally make the connection, oh shit, can all these women channel that just got pointed out? And then you see that same woman in a later scene with Egwene trapped. That would have made a good scene too, if they had made the connection of, this is a channeler, this channeler was captured, this is the same woman that was captured that's now stuck in a cell next to Egwene and has been broken.
Yeah.
Like, all those changes would have been minor changes, I think, but they would have played out better and would have driven home just how horrible this practice is of capturing pets, essentially. Pal world.
Yeah. And I think, at the same time, the show still does a terrific job at showing how horrible these people are, because I remember the impression and the feelings that I had at the end of the season, and I felt for them. You feel for Egwene. When we get to that part where she goes through what she's going to go through, it is intense. Very similar, if not more intense than what Nynaeve goes through in this episode.
Right. Yeah, I agree. And actually, it's even worse in the book.
I remember you saying that.
Yeah, when we get to that episode, we'll talk about it. I'll pull the relevant passages from the book up, and you can make your own determination. Okay, so the next scene is that I grabbed was this. So again, somebody standing and just looking down at the ground to me is more authoritative than the Suldam kneeling down by the spike. And I think the show is trying to show like that the Suldam is more powerful but still has to kneel. But this Damani chick with the gold collar should have been like on the floor. Like, she's less than property. And I don't think they demonstrated that well in this scene.
No, she seems like a bad bitch.
Yeah.
And that's the impression I felt the entire season when I watched her, was this girl is a badass.
Does this girl die? Like, do you remember? Ooh, does she, the chick with the pacifier? Does she die?
I think so. Because I feel like she was up at the top of the tower with Egwene at the end of the season.
Uh-huh.
And I feel like everybody died up there except for Egwene and her.
Suldam.
Damani? Suldam.
Yeah. Damn. I was really hoping.
I could be wrong, though.
There is a Damani that I'm looking forward to seeing. I can't really talk about it, but I'm looking for her. I hope she shows up. She better make it into the show or I'm going to be pissed. Okay, so my next one is, I just tried to grab this scene here because the chick on the left is like giving them a speech. And it's, I think she... Oh yeah, the Lady Suroth in the middle.
Yep, there's two of them right there.
Yeah, the lady on the left is giving like a speech, and this is kind of like a delivery thing, like we talked about with Iroh yesterday. Is she's giving the speech, and it's appropriate, but I think the tone was, you know what? I'm gonna say that it felt right. I feel like her reaction to people talking back to her was wrong, but I feel like her initial speech was appropriately dystopian, because that's the way the Seanchan function. They basically, they're like a force of nature. They roll in, they take over, you swear the oaths, and then they move on. Like, they just barrel through villages a lot. And they capture Damani, give him the speech, get him to swear the oaths, and that's it. And if you break the rules, you die. Essentially.
Yeah. I I mean, I don't have the background that you do with this, but for me, I didn't notice anything off or amiss with it.
Okay.
You know, obviously, she's second. Or, you know, I don't even feel like she's in command. I feel like, you know, she's a piece of property for this lady what?
Lady Suroth, and you're right. She is Suroth's property. That's correct.
Yeah. And that's kind of the vibe I got. So, you know, when people talk back, you know, it wouldn't make sense for her to get emotional, and it wouldn't make sense for Lady Suroth in her position of power and authority to get visually upset. She just whip of her fingers, you're dead, Uno. Who's next?
Right.
Who wants to open their mouth next?
And I think the camera even zoomed in on Suroth's face as she was like, had a small smile and turned into like a frown, and then she killed him. Yeah. That was it for that scene. The next part of Perrin's arc is when the Dark One is in there, and he tells Perrin, you know, I want to meet the monster. And
oh yeah, I like this.
You liked it. I didn't like anything about this. This whole piece of his story, I didn't enjoy at all. But we could still go through it. I get why you like it. I don't.
Yeah, I mean, for one, it was intense. And this,
right,
for me, I feel like is the first real dialogue you get between him and a dark friend.
Okay.
That you're aware of. You know, because for me, Ishmael's a dark one until proven otherwise. Or not Ishmael, but Ingtar. But this also, it's like Ishmael knows what Perrin is. We don't know what he is. Moraine doesn't really understand what he is from what I've heard her talk on about the situation. They kind of have an idea, but nobody knows for sure. Ishmael's like, the opinion that I got was, I know what you are. And the more you tap into that monster, that rage, the more I own you. That's where I want you. And I mean, that's what he says. You know, the closer you are to, I think he said the monster or whatever word he used, he's like, the more I own you.
Right.
And so that was a cool moment for me, because it's just a little bit more insight into what's going on with Perrin, because I'm trying to figure that out.
Right, and they're using an external force with the Shamael giving you what Perrin is thinking in the books. Because you don't get to, obviously you can't, unless you have the actor narrate for himself, you don't get to see what he's thinking. So they had to make a Shamael have this dialogue with Perrin to give him that, like, a reason for that fear. But in the books, he's scared of it all on his own. He's terrified. He doesn't want it. And
was it Ishmael ever even in the village with Lady Suroth when Perrin gets captured?
No.
Okay.
No. And also, I mean, for the record, Ishmael is batshit insane and only cares about the dragon. He does not care about anybody else.
That makes sense. Okay.
Like, they've transformed Ishmael into like a general bad guy, kind of like they did with Pot on Fane. And I think for the show, it's okay, because they need those vehicles to, like, that was their solution to missing internal dialogue, is have these characters perform that function so that the themes are there. It's tough on the readers, because this is not the Ishmael I know. Ishmael is a raving madman. He's batshit insane, and if he had been in the room with Perrin ever, he would have killed him.
Yeah, I could see that from the book perspective. For me, for the show, it makes sense that he would do this, because it builds his character up more to be the master manipulator of all evil things going on. Like, Ishmael is pulling the strings of everything.
Yeah, and that's the way he's. They're actually, what's funny is the show is giving Ishmael the idealized version of himself that he thinks he has in the books. In the books, he thinks he's this big mastermind, when really he's had like 2,000 years to take over the world, and he's an idiot. So this is actually Ishmael that he wishes he could be.
enough.
So he scares Perrin. Now I see, you know, in hindsight, this is why Perrin is afraid of his power in the show. Now that he's been kind of scared by Ishamael, and then he gets the cherry on the ice cream with this scene. He gets broken out by Elias, and Elias's face is covered in blood because apparently he tore the throat out of a guard.
Is he shapeshift?
No. If he does, I'm going to stop watching the show.
Yeah, they haven't hinted at it. I find it fascinating that... I mean, he's very animalistic in his characteristics of himself.
Oh, that's 100% feral. Accurate. Yeah, he's kind of feral.
So I because there's so much mystique about what Perrin is and how Elias is tied to him and this whole pack mentality.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just like, do they, you know, I'm just grasping at things. Is Perrin a shapeshifter? You know, is Elias one that Perrin just doesn't understand? He's the same thing as Perrin. And, you know, I'm really reaching here, but
they, okay. So they are the same. They are what they call wolf brothers. They are exaggerating a lot of Elias's characteristics for the show. Elias is a lot more, he's an excellent and fierce fighter, but he's a lot more laid back than this scene calls for. I don't think Elias ever tore anybody's throat out with his teeth. He's called Longtooth by the other wolves because he has this long-ass knife that he carries with him. And he kills people with that just fine. He doesn't need to go rip teeth out or rip throats out with his teeth. So it's an exaggeration. It's nice and fierce looking on screen. Not accurate, but I like it because if you're following the theme of Perrin being afraid of his power, what better way than have a crazy man with blood on his face break you out of jail? Like, do I even want to go with this guy at this point?
Yeah.
And that's the end. That's the end of my screenshots for Perrin. I didn't know if you had to wanted to circle back or move on. I got Rand up next.
I think we covered pretty much everything with that.
Yeah, one of my YouTube shorts, they accused me of hyping up the show for no reason, or like making excuses for them, and I am to a degree. I like the show, but it's not the book. So, but I still like the show, and I'm trying to put myself in their heads so that we can appreciate season 3 when it comes out, because I think it's going to get even better if they continue on this path of improvement. To start Rand's arc in this episode, he's talking with Loghain, and Loghain like demands a bottle of red wine from Gildon, and Loghain seems to be aware of who Rand is. I think they do like a flashback to them at the White Tower, if I'm not mistaken.
I don't remember that flashback, but I do agree with you that he definitely knows who Rand is.
Right. This is the scene, or right around here is where, when you and I were talking about season 1, where Loghain was in the White Tower, you thought he was looking at Matt. And
yeah, I don't remember that flashback in this episode. Maybe I'm wrong. I really don't remember it.
That's all right. But anyways, so Rand leaves the infirmary and comes out here, and I took a screenshot of an actual Glee Man with the patches on his cloak talking about the hunt for the horn. And I did like that Tom had his sewn in. I thought that was a nice touch on the inside of his coat. But this is what a traditional Glee Man more or less looks like. It's multicolored. It's got patches all over the place. It's just an identifying marker. And then this was interesting. It's supposed to be just an oath, but apparently the show wanted to make it a little more noticeable. I think I know why. I have a prediction. I don't know if you mind if I make my prediction now. I don't want to spoil anything. I don't think it's a spoiler. It is. So, okay, I'm going to make my spoiler-free prediction that we're going to meet a hunter for the horn that becomes somebody's wife. I think that's as close as I can get. Okay. Somebody's wife. That's as close as I can get without, and I probably already revealed too much.
Okay. How much you on that for a while?
Yeah. And this is gonna be the indicator. She's gonna, you know, the conversation's gonna happen between the two characters. The sleeve's gonna come up for some reason. Oh, you're a hunter for the horn. Like that's what the show's gonna do, I think, and that's how they're going to introduce this character. And instead of her talking about being a hunter for the horn, the other character is going to notice that she's a hunter for the horn.
Okay.
Because that's the only reason I can think of that they would be doing this branding thing, is the visual aid, so you can catch it. Okay, so moving on to the dinner party. I kind of skipped over this. I watched it all the way, but my brain started tuning out because this was like amateur hour for drama. I didn't really enjoy it. It was an interesting concept. I think it would have taken a little more development to really get the point across. I know what they're trying to do and demonstrate the game of the Dais de Mar, the game of houses, and it's clumsy here. I'm not really happy with the way it went. I don't know how to improve it, and that's the big thing for me. If I can't improve it, then they must have done their best.
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, really the only thing that stood out to me was just that Matt or Rand met Moraine's sister.
That's a good point. That's the older woman that hands him the invitation, I think. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So maybe that was a big portion of why this scene existed. I didn't realize that was Moraine's sister. I just thought it was some high lady.
Is it not?
Well, I'm not saying it's not. I'm saying I don't know.
Okay.
If I saw Moraine's sister, I don't remember.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like it was her, and then she tried to talk to Celine, and she was like, "Yeah, I don't feel like we've been introduced." And she was like, "Yeah, we haven't. Okay, bye."
That's funny. None of this happens in the books. It's partly why I'm not interested, and partly because I thought it was clumsy and. But Celine acting like that towards a high lady is pretty funny. She's very confident in herself, and we'll see that in a slide or two. Moving on, Rand finishes his quest and gets the guild done in red, and then goes back to Loghain, and Loghain proceeds to go on a rant and act absolutely insane.
Yeah. So this line right here is actually in my notes. I brought that up. The blood of Luthern flows through his veins.
Yeah.
I didn't know if that had any significance or not.
Well, it's inaccurate.
Caught my attention.
It's inaccurate.
Okay.
He's just insane in the show. He's. Yeah. I mean, for the record, he's not insane in the books. This I see what they're doing. I guess I can explain it. This him blaming the Aes Sedai of this big grand conspiracy theory happens in like book 6 or 7, and he has to be led to the idea. So they kind of waved their hand and washed all that away by making him crazy. So now he's got this conspiracy theory in his head, and he believes it 100%. And they're basically using his quote-unquote madness to escalate the story, which I guess is fine, but they better not change his outcome at the end of the series, or I'm going to be pretty pissed. Like, this is this is a change to a plot device, and the way they're changing it makes his ending arc at risk, and I'm not going to be happy if they adjust that. I see it.
Messed up somebody's arc in this episode specifically.
Well, yeah, and they're doing it a lot, but they can save it. Like, a lot of these, they can be saved. Like, I can think of a way to save this particular problem right now. I can save it in season 4 or 5 or whatever. Like, down the road, I could salvage this. It's just irritating that they made this choice. So these are going to be part of my hot takes, and heavy spoilers for you if we discuss all my hot takes on stream.
Yeah, we'll save it.
So Rand gets frustrated, and you see kind of his anger boil over, like tries to intimidate Loghain. And then he storms out, and then walks into the room, and Celine is like, "I'll kill you." And I thought that was interesting. I'm gonna walk away for a second, but I can still hear you.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, for me, you know, now knowing who she is and the backstory of her character, this makes sense. At the time, it really didn't. I was just like, man, this girl is really bold. Especially with what comes right after this, where Rand's powers kind of start to overflow out of him. I mean, you see him for a while through the last couple episodes really build this frustration and inability to control the itch that he has for the One Power, and he's desperate. And I think that's where, you know, the conflict for him with Loghain and that conversation and how it all played out and the frustration of the answer really just came boiling over for him. Yeah, I think they did a good job at getting that point across. Now, I don't know how it goes in the book, but for the show's sake, I think that I'm getting the highlights of what I'm supposed to with it.
Right.
If you can add to that.
Yeah. I'm conflicted. I think that they're getting the point across well enough. And I think this is the scene where she confronts him and threatens him, and you said she was bold, and then especially with this next scene where, like, he's on top of her and starts losing control, and she's like, one, she can see him doing it, which I have a problem with, but two, she's like fascinated by it or proud of him or whatever, not scared. So anybody that was new to the show, that should have been a big indicator of something not being quite right.
Sussy subject number 2, right there.
Say that again.
Sussy subject number 2. So we got Ingtar.
Uh-huh.
And we got Celine. I mean, obviously, this show's been out for a while. We know from our personal experience how Celine's arc is going to play out and her true intentions and backstory. But at this point in the show, you don't know. But yeah, I mean, you brought up a great point. She sees this and she's not surprised, and that's massive red flag.
Yeah, she's proud of him. Like, yeah. That was the feeling that I got when I watched the scene. Was that she's like, there he is, basically.
Yeah, I think for her and her intentions, she's getting Rand to where she wants him to be.
Right.
You know, where he's, you know, giving into the power and not into his ability to control himself.
I don't necessarily have a problem with it, but there was a scene, and it's, I say I don't have a problem with it. So in a scene with Celine, Rand is asking Celine about the Horn of Valyr. And do you remember, like, her attitude towards that? Like, did you pick up on that at all?
Yeah. From what I can remember off the top of my head, I feel like she was pretty indifferent towards it.
Right.
Or non-concerned about it.
Dismissive was what came to mind when I watched it. And
trying to make him share her sentiment, I guess. Or maybe let that rub off on him. Like, oh, it's nothing. It's probably not even real. Like, you don't need to worry about it. Don't concern yourself with this fairy tale.
Right. So, this was, it's probably not even worth talking about. It's backwards. In the book, it was backwards. She's very interested in the horn and wants him to find it and blow it. Like, it's trying to tempt him with power, basically.
Gotcha.
So,
okay.
If you ever get that far in the books, you're going to read it and be like, wait a minute. None of this is making sense. But anyways, yeah, that was my only other comment about that. A lot of people bitched about that scene in particular when she was like dismissive of it. It's still manipulative, which is at the heart what Celine is a manipulator. It's just not manipulating the way I was expecting.
That's fair.
Ultimately has very little impact on the overall story, but it is a detail that was different. So I wanted to go back to, I think Egwene is last. Oh no, Egwene and Matt. We still have Matt to do. If you were done talking about Rand.
Yeah, I think we covered everything.
Yeah, so Egwene's arc is pretty short. I only have 4 screenshots, and it's mostly around Nynaeve being gone.
Yeah, I mean, I don't feel like she had much going on in this episode other than, you know, her experiencing the loss of Nynaeve.
Right.
Which is dramatic, and, you know, rightly so. You know, and the people around her trying to console her and her inability to just let that happen, to just move on from somebody who's been a great friend of yours your entire life, you know, to just lose them to the arch. I did like her conflict, her confrontation with Leandrin, which right. kind of added to my suspicion of what Leandrin did on purpose. And I think it also kind of maybe gave a little foreshadowing to, maybe not foreshadowing, but in a way, to Egwene's character. Because I feel like when Egwene's powers or position or role to play in the world is brought up, it is always downplayed, or like she is a weak member, or she is outshined by everybody around her, like the dragon and Nynaeve.
Right.
Leandrin was kind of giving her a bit of advice here, like the ones who survive are the ones who write history. You know?
Right.
Not always the most powerful.
Right.
And so that just kind of stuck out to me for her arc, just from our conversations of what I know about Egwene. And she's a witty survivor.
That is a very accurate. That's a very accurate description. Yeah, she's a witty survivor and stronger than people are giving her credit for, which we'll find out once she's with the Seanchan. So this scene, all of this is like none of this happens. It's part of why her arc is so short in this series, or in this episode in particular. None of this happens in the book. So a lot of this is just character development on her part. You know, she's upset in the scene where she finds out that Nynaeve is dead. She runs Elaine off. I don't even know you, which is not true. They already have been trying to bond. She's just upset. And you get to see some of Shiriam's coldness towards the, you know, like, it is what it is. The wheel weaves as the wheel wills, like that. If you're going to be an Aes Sedai, you're going to have to deal with it kind of speech. And then here she approaches another Aes Sedai and is pissed. And, you know, like, you're going to talk to me. And then Leandrin, like, casually blows out the flames, like, you don't even know what I can do to you. And, like, basically implies that she's going to throw her off the tower, and then backs up and, you know, gives her a little motivational speech. And, you know, like, I think, this is next, is she goes down to the arches and is trying her best to save Nynaeve. And so she, like, went through her stage of grief. She went through anger, and then she's, like, bound and determined, I'm gonna save Nynaeve when everybody else failed. Like, what a character trait.
Yeah. Absolutely. I think you hit a lot of good points right there about her arc.
Yeah, and then, you know, another, she ran Elaine off, but you can see Elaine's character starting to really show through here. Like, basically tells her, like, it's a lost cause. And then once she sees that Egwene is determined, says, fine, I'll wait with you. You know, I don't want you to get in trouble. And, like, that was a good scene. It was, like I said, none of it happened, but it was still a good scene. Good yeah. Character development for Egwene, and a little bit of character development for Elaine as well.
And, I mean, big emotional scenes, you know? I mean, that's what they got to go for in a TV show. In a book, you have time to, you know, you spend a lot more time with the content than you do in a TV show. And so they really, in an hour, have to give you a ton of emotional ups and downs to keep you hooked and engaged with the show.
And right.
With the little time that Egwene was on screen, I feel like they gave you a ton of emotion for her. You know, even when it kind of ties into Matt's arc that we're about to talk about, you know, with her crying in the courtyard. Which mm-hmm. is a little bit before this, you know, I think it was done well.
Yeah, I thought so too. And then the end of the episode is Nynaeve busts back through. I didn't catch a scene of the, I didn't catch the group hug. But you know, it wasn't anything that Egwene did. It turns out. Right, it was, or maybe it was. I mean, Egwene's launching Weaves of Spirit at this arch. For all we know, that's what triggered. Nynaeve to see it in the first place. Because I don't think Nynaeve did anything specific. I think the arch was. I'll have to go back and watch the scene. I can't remember. But I thought the arch was already trying to appear. No, I have a theory.
No, I don't think so.
Maybe it was
her attempt to save Nynaeve was what set the things in the arch in motion to set Nynaeve up to return?
No,
Don't be greedy, share with the class.
I'm thinking. Thinking takes a minute. So one of my wild ass guess was let me go to, I'm about to skip really fast through here. So my half cuck theory was this scene where she's starting to get stuck. Because of the time dilation that I was, like, talking about, this arch could be Egwene trying to get her out, and she just doesn't see it.
Ooh.
Because Egwene's not strong enough.
And that's why it doesn't stay.
And that's why it doesn't stay, and why Nynaeve can't hear it. or can't feel it or whatever, because she thinks she heard something. And then you go back to this, and we've already talked about her strength and the power at this point. And that kind of makes sense. I don't know if they'll ever talk about it. It's not really worth pursuing. That's just kind of like a hot take. But the implication would be that because she rejected the White Tower, that one of the three women just let her stay in there. Which it wasn't Leandrin, because Leandrin was pissed. So it had to have been one of the other two. I don't know. I need to think about that some more, because it kind of fits with some of the themes of the book, but doesn't fit perfectly. And now I'm wondering if this is the show being clever more than I was already giving them credit for.
Okay. Now in that theory, that's opened a question for me that I feel like I need clarification on, and if it's going to spoil too many things for me.
Mm-hmm.
You have every right not to answer. Is Min considered a dark friend? Because she is working with Leandrin. And I mean, obviously it's on screen, they're in cahoots. And Leandrin has some kind of manipulation over Min. But from what I've seen, I just don't feel like she is a dark friend.
Min is not a dark friend.
Okay. I just didn't know if, because of, you know, her being involved with Leandra, if that would be your consideration of the one dark friend that I'm missing, because she is kind of acting on behalf of Leandra.
When I say somebody is a dark friend, I mean like confirmed from the books, full on have done something, either found out that they were a dark friend or self-declared that they were a dark friend.
Gotcha.
That, you know, like obviously when I go back and read the books and I see these characters, they don't say it right away. You find out like 8 books later or whatever, and you're like, God damn it, I like that character.
I'm gonna be hunting down this one dark friend that I can't put my finger on.
You can probably use process of elimination if.
Yeah, I feel like, for me, I feel like it has to be another Aes Sedai. Aes Sedai.
I mean, I don't want to give you any more hints.
Is that hot or cold?
It's warm.
Okay.
The problem is because of the casting choices and because of their limited budget, they don't have a lot of Aes Sedai on screen. And so, like, it's, if I were to break down like how many Dark Friends, how many Forsaken, how many Black Aja, it would be really easy for you to piece that together like really fast.
For sure. And I kind of had a suspicion that it was another Aes Sedai,
right.
I think 2 episodes ago when we were kind of breaking it down.
Yeah,
I just really didn't know where to throw my shot. But, man, I really feel like it's... I mean, I feel like you told me the person of... I'm forgetting her title, but the person who's in charge of all the novices, the mistress of the novices or something like that?
The mistress of novices is Shiriam Bayanar, I think is her last name.
Okay. That's who I felt like was the one that I was missing.
Okay.
We don't have to dive into it. I feel like if I keep pushing, I'll either be wrong and push you into giving me the answer, or I'm right and just spoil it for everybody else.
Well, that's... I mean, talking about it is fine. My big concern is this is why I'm looking forward to going into season 3, is because everyone's going to start on the same playing field, and Going forward, when we talk about it, it won't be a spoiler for anybody because I'll know if it's public knowledge or not. I don't remember the rest of season two to feel comfortable talking about dark friends that we don't find out about until the end of the season. You know what I mean? Like, I think we get a betrayal from Leandrin, so it's okay. We get a betrayal from Celine, so it's okay. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to spoil it. You know, it's why I don't even feel it's okay to have a hot take, you know, like hot takes like Shiryam, or you're 100%, you know, you're 90% there on Inktar or whatever. You know, we can talk about the hot takes. I don't want to confirm or deny anything specific until I know where the show ends on season two. And I'm gonna have like a confirmed list on my end that the show has like revealed. That way, when I'm talking about like dark friends in season three, I feel confident that like I know who has been revealed and who hasn't. If that makes sense.
That's fair. I'm gonna keep collecting evidence on the Mistress of Novices.
Okay. But
when it comes to Inktar, it hurts me because I like this character, but I really do feel, thinking about everything, he's sussy.
Okay. We'll have to wait and see.
Yeah. I do feel like in this show, the sentiment I feel from confirmed dark friends, which really in this conversation is just Celine and Leandrin, and I guess if I'm considering Inktar one, I feel a sense of, I'm trying to think of the best way to word this. Like, they do share all those characteristics that you talked about, and I'll exclude Inktar for the moment, but of ambition and power, but also like a sense of they almost kind of hesitate with the evil things that they have to do. I mean, we can get into Celine a little bit later whenever those moments come up, when their moments of betrayal come up. I just feel like I sense a bit of regret, maybe, or just remorse for what they're doing.
Right. We shouldn't be feeling anything of that from Celine. That should be that's a flaw in the show if they portray that at all. If anything, she's showing regret that she has to bully Rand, but as far as like doing evil things, that should be like really easy. That should be like really easy for her.
I don't feel like it's hard for her to do evil things. I just feel like she genuinely wants Rand and wants.
Oh, that's 100% true.
She couldn't, I mean, you know, she's obviously on the dark side, but she really couldn't give a fuck less about like doing what Ishmael wants or the Dark One wants. She just wants Rand.
Accurate. I'm glad you got that feeling. Leandrin, other Black Aja, other dark friends, a recurring theme in the books is that they're ambitious. They want this power, but they don't realize what it costs until it's too late, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
So.
And I feel like maybe that's the regret that I'm seeing, or the remorse, is that, you know, they're realizing the cost of the decisions that they've made.
Right.
At least on Leandrin's side, because I feel like I see that in her character.
Okay. All right. Well, last character arc is, I literally only have three slides. I'm not real happy with any of this, but we can go through it real quick. I have a hot take on what I think is going to happen to Matt in season three, kind of based on this scene, this arc that he goes through. That was cooking in my brain last night while I was asleep. But anyway, so Leandrin loses Nynaeve, walks in here. I don't think she's taking pity on Matt. I think she just doesn't have the energy to get rid of him or to deal with him anymore. So that's my theory. I don't remember exactly what happens in the rest of the season, but I just think she's just sick of him and wants him out.
Yeah,
and then
that's fair.
I didn't catch the scene after she talks to him, but she is being really brutal with him and basically like is tearing him down emotionally. Like, you already abandoned them. What makes you think they would want you at all? Kind of talk. And then she tells him that Egwene needs you. Did I remember that right?
Yeah, I don't remember her saying that Egwene needs him, but that she definitely could have said that, because I don't remember this conversation verbatim. I do remember her telling him that she is in the tower, like Egwene is here, and then kind of pieces out.
Right.
I also thought Elias was in season one, so, you know.
Yeah, who knows?
Yeah.
Then the next scene that we really see Matt in is, I think he goes out and sees Egwene like all upset and then hesitates and then leaves. doesn't approach her at all.
Yeah, man. It's just frustrating watching Matt's character. And I feel like I carry that same sentiment that I had in season one, where I just didn't really like him. I don't feel like it's until the end of season two where I really start to root for him.
Okay. I need to see what else happens. Like I said, I don't remember a lot of this.
Yeah, so he goes out to the courtyard, sees her, doesn't approach, he essentially just goes back to his cell, and he talks to Min, like pulls her to come over to him, and when Min hops in, she sees the door open, and Matt's just kind of like, I think because of his emotion, the way that Leandrin broke him down emotionally, and him being confronted with the opportunity to talk to Egwene, and he passed it, he's just sulking in himself again, that kind of beaten dog mentality. And right. He's like, you know, I have nowhere to go. I might as well be here. You're the only friend I really have. And Min's like, dog, I'm not sitting here. Like, you could sulk by yourself. That door's open. I'm taking the opportunity. And Matt's like, she's right. And it's also somebody else to kind of go with him. You know, he's not alone anymore. So if she leaves, then he doesn't have to leave by himself.
Right.
And it seemed like it was all kind of a masterful plan from Leandrin, because whenever, right before they take off, Min goes, slips away to talk to Leandrin, and Leandrin says to Min, she's like, if anything, he's not predictable, you know. Or if anything, he's predictable.
Right. Yeah, he's predictable. And this is the screenshot where I want to, like, not going to argue about your suspicion that Min is a dark friend. I just want to try to reframe it a little bit. Moraine is saying, or Leandrin is saying, Moraine won't have anything over either of us. So I feel like, Min, like it was explained to us in season one that Min is kind of vulnerable when she's near the White Tower in the show. And I think this is just what Leandrin is talking about. Like, if you can get out of the tower, you know, we can solve some of these problems.
Yeah, I agree. And I don't really feel like Min is a dark friend. I was just wondering if that would be something you counted as a dark friend because of this relationship that they have right here.
Right.
Because I think that Min is, you know, has a good heart. I don't feel like she's ambitious. I just feel like, you know, she's kind of caught up in a situation she doesn't want to be in, a lot like the other Tiberian, the other kids, you know, just because of her abilities, she's thrust into this situation at hand because of her ability to read people, which makes her important.
Right.
And she doesn't want that.
I don't have any more screenshots. I'm out.
I feel like we did a, you know.
It's another
longer than we thought, but
it's another 2 hours. I think it's because we got really. I spent a lot of time on like the arch mechanics. That was my fault. Part of it was, at least.
Like we fleshed this out pretty well.
Yeah, I didn't mean to dig into the book so far. I just, this is one of those episodes where them changing things is going to have potential consequences down the road. And I was trying to think, like, how would I fix it if I was in their shoes? So,
All fair points. I do feel like the conversation was a lot easier and